Welcome all for the second part of our trying and insertion of complete dangers. This is the final step in the construction of dangers. The primary aim is to insert processes which will enhance comfort, function and aesthetic of the patient. So proper fitting of the danger should be ensured to achieve this goal. According to the glossary of prosthodontic term, danger insertion is defined as the process of directing a prosthesis to the desired location. So there are various steps involved in the insertion of dangers, and it has been summarized into 10 points or 10 categories. These are the aspects which you should look when you insert a complete denture. This is the minimal criteria. You can have an extensive criteria which you can develop by yourself, which will be gained through years of experience as well as practice. So as a newer or upcoming dentist, you should follow at least these 10 points when you insert a complete denture. You can work upon these criteria and you can implement new methods of checking your denture prior to insertion. So we will see what are those 10 factors which you should inspect when you insert a complete denture, complete processed denture. First is inspecting the processed denture as soon as you receive it from the laboratory or when you receive it from the technician. The second part is evaluating the interferences to the seating of dangers. First part is inspecting the process dangers, that is the intaglio surface and the polished surface of the danger. Second aspect which you should be checking is evaluating the interferences to the seating of the danger. Third is checking the fullness of the denture inside the oral cavity. Fourth, checking the degree of tooth and mucosa visibility. Fifth, checking clearance at the heel of the dentures, that is for the maxillary denture, the tuberosity area, and for the mandibular denture, the retromolar pad areas. Sixth, checking the clearance at the anterior region. Seven, testing occlusal pattern for any prematurities which you have developed during the processing of your complete denture. Eight, asking the patient about the comfort of the basal seat. Nine, testing for the coincidence of centric relation and centric occlusion. And the final point which you need to check is testing the periphery of the denture for excessive thickness, height, and the snugness. Height and the fit, snuggy fit of the denture. These are the 10 factors which you should look when you insert a complete denture. This is the criteria which most of the textbook tells. You can, as I told earlier, you can improvise on this various aspects, and you can increase the number of areas which you need to check prior to inserting your complete denture, so that there will be minimal post-operative complaints and you have a satisfied patient. So we will see what are the 10 factors individually, what all things comes under each of these factors, so that it will be easy for you to insert a complete denture later on when you come to the clinic or when you start your practice. So two things which you have to tell the patient before coming for insertion is that if the patient is using any old denture, he should remove his old denture at least 15 minutes prior to his visit to the clinic. And ask him to bring along with him any adhesive powder if it has been required. In some cases, for the initial psychological advance, patient might require some adhesive powders or a paste, because you may not come across patients with good rids wherein you can provide a good retentive danger. In some cases, in most of the cases, you have a resorbed ridge which can have an initial compromise in the retention. So as a psychological advantage, you can increase the retention by providing this kind of adhesive powder along with the complete danger. So these are the two factors or two things which you should advise the patient prior to his appointment for insertion. So we will see what is the first point out of the 10 points which I have told earlier. That is, first one is inspecting the process danger. You should always inspect the tissue site carefully for any beads or nodules, because the dentist himself should check it prior to the placement. It is a mandatory procedure. Most of the time, the laboratory technicians who have processed the danger would have checked it, but it is your moral responsibility to check it by yourself. If the laboratory technician have missed some beads or nodules, you should be the one who is going to identify these nodules and the beads, and you should correct it prior to the insertion. If you doesn't do that, there will be some nicks or accidental deformations or any tear which will be there in the oral cavity during the insertion, and which might have a deleterious effect later on, because the patient is going to use the denture newly, and any unwanted trauma might delay the comfort of the patient because of those nick as well as tear which has been caused by means of this nodules or beads. So you need to check the nodules and the beads prior to the insertion. Then should make sure that the adaptation of the denture to the tissue surface of the cast is proper. If you feel that there is any suspicious area where it is not been proper as you have seen in the cast on the tissue surface, please check it in the oral cavity. In some cases, what happens is during processing or acrylization, the acrylic material would not have flown into the deepest portion of the sulcus or into the undercut area which you have thought of utilizing for retention. You might see that the tissue surface is not proper. So if you feel that this area is not looking similar to what it is there in the cast, or this area is not adapted to the cast properly, then you should visualize that area in the oral cavity, and then you should confirm that what you have there in the denture tissue surface is similar to what it is there in the oral cavity. So these are the two things which you need to look in prior to your second point, that is before seating the denture. So these things need to be taken care, and if there is anything of this sort, it should be corrected. Once you have done that, you can proceed to the next step, that is evaluating interferences to the seating of the denture. So the first part was, or the first thing which you need to inspect during your insertion is inspecting the processed denture before placement right inside the oral cavity. That is, you need to look for the beads and nodules and the adaptation or the tissue surface area, whether it is been mimicking exactly what you have recorded during your secondary impression or what you are seeing in your master cast. Second is evaluating the interferences to the seating of the denture. So the flange of the denture should be examined for the presence of undercut that may bruise the tissue. Sometimes what happens is you would have engaged a few undercuts for better retention, especially in case of mandibular denture, the distolingual flange area or the retromyelohyoid curtain area. You would have recorded it in your impression, and you want that impression, you want that area to be there in your denture flange. In some cases, if it is being utilized bilaterally, there is always a possibility that there is some kind of difficulty in inserting your mandibular denture. So you need to identify that area, and you need to check for any bruises or difficulty if the patient says when you insert, when you try to insert your lower complete denture, or sometimes either maxillary tuberosity area or the anterior area, anterior flange area in maxillary denture, when the patient is saying there is some difficulty, you would need to identify, check whether any bruise is there on the soft tissue or the mucosa of your oral cavity. And if it is there, you need to correct that area, and you need to make sure that all the interferences during the seating are eliminated, and you should insert your denture slowly and steadily with gentle pressure, and it should not just snap it into the place. So most of the time, out of enthusiasm, you try to exert too much of force when you insert your complete denture for the first time. What I mean to say that you should avoid that kind of enthusiasm when you insert your denture. You should eliminate those undercuts which is being utilized or which is causing some kind of uneasiness or bruise on the tissues, and you should insert your denture gently and slowly without traumatizing or without causing any pain to the patient. So that is the second point which you need to look into when you insert your processed complete denture. Now moving on with our third point, that is checking the fullness of the mouth on insertion of your complete denture, that is checking the fullness after inserting your complete denture. So you should scrutinize the facial contour to see that it is pleasing after immediately after inserting your complete denture. In some cases there will be excessive fullness at the lip area and at the base of the nose, and it should be corrected. Otherwise the aesthetics of your denture will cause gross changes in the facial features which may not be acceptable to the patient. So one thing which I always implement in my practice is immediately after placing my maxillary complete denture, I try to run my finger right from the cheek down to the lip, and I will see whether there is a smooth transition of the soft tissue present in that area. If there is any kind of bulging or if there is a kind of interferences, that shows that your flange is excessively thick, or it might interfere with the muscle function. So you need to correct those areas. Sometimes it might be because of excessive wax which you have added up during the sealing stage of your complete denture. This is what happens with most of the students. After the try-in, they try to seal their complete denture to the master cast prior to their acrylization. So what they do is they again add some amount of wax on the flange area during the sealing procedure. This will increase the thickness of flange in the anterior region considerably. And this will on insertion, this will act as a protuberance or a bulge on the soft tissue which can cause or which can compromise the aesthetics. So always I tell my students that when you are sealing the waxed up denture onto the cast, the sealing has to be done only along the borders. You are not going to change the flange thickness, or you are not going to change the flange height when you seal your complete denture to the cast. If you do so, there is always possibility that the fullness of the mouth will be increased immediately on insertion of your complete denture. So it should be made mandatory that whatever contour or height or thickness which you have adapted or which you have achieved during your trying stage, which is being appreciated by the patient, has to be reproduced exactly. If you yourself are not doing the processing of your complete denture, if you are giving to the laboratory technician also, you should communicate this factor or this aspect to the laboratory technician to make sure that he doesn't do any alternation to the thickness as well as the contour or the height of your, the flange of the complete denture, which has been trying successfully tried in successfully in the oral cavity of the patient, and you yourself has been satisfied with the trying. So you have to implement this factor, otherwise there is always possibility that you will end up in increasing the fullness on insertion of your complete denture, which you may have to trim later on, which may not be as satisfactory as always, because you had taken your consent from your patient regarding the aesthetics, and when you processed your denture, it has undergone some change, and naturally the patient will not take it as a positive factor, and he might always have a confusion inside his mind whether what happened, is there anything went wrong with the denture, it is not looking as similar as what it was there in the trying stage. So always try to reduce the amount of adjustment which you are during your insertion period by so that you can gain more confidence from your patient, and whatever you have done in your trying stage, you were able to replicate it properly, and that naturally will boost up the confidence of you as well as the patient. So that was the third point which you need to check. So the next point, or moving on to the next point, that is checking the degree of tooth and the mucosa visibility. So after checking the fullness, you need to check the tooth and mucosa visibility. So you need to make sure that there is no much visibility of the mucosa when the patient speaks or when the patient smiles, because the flange of your denture, if you are not able to exactly mimic your shade of oral cavity with the flange, that is nowadays you can use various colors to mimic the same shade of your mucosa onto the denture flange, but it is not possible always. So what happens is, when the patient smiles or when the patient talks, if there is excessive mucosa visibility, the pink or the denture base color pops out, and that might impair the confidence of the patient to speak properly or to laugh or smile properly without any interference or without any inhibition. So you need to make sure that the degree of tooth and mucosa visibility is exactly what you wanted, and there is no over visibility or over exposure of the tooth and mucosa on insertion of your complete denture. And the patient needs to be communicated regarding the mucosa visibility and tooth visibility, that in some cases there is chance that some amount of mucosa will be visible on laughing, which you cannot avoid in some cases. So in those kind of patients, you try to characterize your denture flange as natural as possible by incorporating some amount of colors which is quite similar to the mucosa of the residual alveolar ridge, or much pleasing, that is is not looking artificial in any sort, as some patient has got highly plain, and there is always possibility that some amount of mucosa will be visible on laughing. This is the only option, and it needs to be communicated. The one way of avoiding this kind of mucosa visibility is to by selecting tooth which are very long. That some cases when you select those kind of teeth, it will add up to more artificiality, and the aesthetics might be compromised. So it has to be discussed with the patient during the trying stage itself, and that has to be implemented in your insertion. But you can convey the patient, or you can you can talk to the patient regarding that, and you can make sure that the aesthetics is not compromised by selecting a large or a big tooth in order to avoid the mucosal exposure when the patient smiles or laughs. So that has to be the point which you need to take into consideration. So that was the fourth point which you need to check, that is the tooth and the mucosa visibility. Sometimes there is a fact that when you increase the flange thickness, that is, as I told earlier, during the your sealing of your complete denture, when you add extra amount of the wax, that can also compromise or that can also contribute to excessive mucosa visibility in some cases. So that is also another factor which I would like to implement, or which I would like to suggest, that whenever you seal, try to minimize the amount of wax which is being used to seal your complete trine denture onto the cast. Never use excessive wax. As I have seen in few cases during my practice course, whenever the students uses extra amount of wax for sealing, there also the visibility of your tooth as well as mucosa have changed drastically. And whatever visibility was there during the trine stage, the patient was okay. But when it comes to the process danger, that was not happy. The patient was not happy. The patient was say, will most of the time the patient will say that the visibility have increased comparatively than what it was there during the trine stage. Another one factor which I would like to suggest is the laboratory remount procedure also, which you should do in most of your cases. What happens is when the vertical dimension would have changed during your processing to a certain extent, depending upon how perfectly you are realizing your denture. When the vertical dimension also, when the vertical dimension changes, there is also the change in the tooth and mucosa visibility drastically from what you have attained during your trine stage. So that was the fourth point. Now moving on with the fifth point, which you need to check, is checking the clearance at the heel of your denture, that is the maxillary tuberosity and retromolar pad area. This is usually seen as a complication or interference in patients which have who have good ridge and who have reduced interarch space. So during your cases pre-stage itself, you need to identify or you need to record the interarch space which has been available, and it has been characterized as normal, excessive, insufficient, sufficient or not sufficient. So you need to categorize your patient, whether the patient has got sufficient interarch space. If the patient has got sufficient interarch space, then there will not be much of lack of clearance at the heels of the denture. But if there is reduced interarch space, there is always a possibility that the heels of the denture might come into contact, and that can compromise the occlusion achievement or the centric relation which you have registered. So what you are supposed to do if you feel that there is an interference or a lack of clearance due at the heel of your dentures, is to apply a disclosing paste on the heel region, that is the tuberosity area or the retromolar pad area, and ask the patient to close his jaws, or ask him to bring the dentures to occlusion. And you can very well anticipate, or you can appreciate the uniformity of the paste, or you can use even a disclosing wax to check the clearance in that area. If there is any change in the disclosing wax or the disclosing paste which you have applied, then you need to trim those areas, preferably to trim on the retromolar pad area rather than trimming on the tuberosity area, because tuberosity area contributes to the retention of your maxillary denture, which you don't want to compromise in any sort. So So reduce the amount of thickness in that area to the possible extent as the material permits. If it is, then if you can achieve that clearance, then it is well and fine. If it requires still some more correction, then try to do it in the lower danger rather than doing it on the maxillary danger. So that was point number 5, checking the clearance at the heels of the danger. Now moving on with the 6th point, that is checking the clearance in the anterior region. So whenever you give a danger, whenever you insert a danger, there should be some amount of clearance in your anterior aspect. There should not be any contact on the anterior aspect. That is the criteria which you are following based on your balanced occlusal scheme. That is how you have done your preclinical exercise also. You have given overjet, that is the horizontal overlap between the maxillary and mandibular anteriors on maximum intercuspation, and you have given overbite, that is the vertical overlap. So there was a criteria which you need to follow. That means in any of the cases you never gave any kind of occlusion on the anterior region when you did your preclinical exercise. Similarly, you need to eliminate any kind of interferences in the anterior region in your complete danger which you are going to give to your patient also. So what for that, you can check the clearance in the anterior region by placing an articulating paper between the anteriors, that is from canine to canine, and when you pull the articulating paper, the articulating paper should drain through the anteriors freely without any interference in centric relation. This is the criteria which you should get when you do your exercise, that is placing your articulating paper between the incisors and ask the patient to contact in centric relation or guide the patient into the occlusion. And when you drain your articulating paper, draw your articulating paper through the anterior region, it should come out freely without any interference. So after checking the clearance on the heel region or at the heel region, then after checking the clearance in the anterior region, we will move on to the next aspect or next factor which you need to check. That is the 7th factor, that is testing the occlusion for any kind of prematurities. So this is another crucial step or a time consuming step which you have to spend a lot of time during your insertion, especially in your initial days wherein it is difficult to identify the prematurities in occlusion. So as you all know, which the kind of occlusion which you are giving in your complete danger is called as balanced occlusion, wherein you have securing simultaneous contact of anterior and posterior teeth and the left and right region, simultaneous contact in centric position as well as in or in centric relation. So during your processing stage, if you are doing a laboratory remount, in few aspects or a few areas you can correct those interferences, occlusal prematurities in the articulator itself, because the corrections which you do in the articulator most of the during your laboratory remount will try to eliminate most of the prematurities which is being present after your trying. And if you guys doesn't do that laboratory remount, there is always a possibility that there is some kind of interferences. 90% of the cases there will be possibility of some amount of occlusal prematurities as the patient bites in centric relation. So clinically, if you want to identify, you can use some kind of articulating paper on both sides simultaneously and ask the patient to close, or you can guide the patient to close into the centric relation, and you can check for the intensity of the color or for the occlusal prematurities. You should ask the patient to close into centric relation, ask him to stop at that particular point when the teeth comes into contact. When teeth comes into contact, when the first teeth comes into contact, and that area will be marked in your denture, and you can trim those areas and you can eliminate the prematurities. So that itself is a long procedure which we cannot explain in detail during this session, but you have to remember that the point which you need to select or which you need to do is check for the occlusal prematurities. So if you want to know in detail about how to check the occlusal prematurities, it is a different scenario which will take some amount of explanation, which may not be possible in due course of this this lecture. So that is about checking the occlusal prematurities. Next is checking the comfort of the basal seat. So on insertion of the denture, you have to make sure that your patient is very comfortable without any pain or without any uneasiness. This is very essential for checking the next step. So if the patient is not comfortable in the basal seat after the insertion of your newly processed complete denture, then the next step in evaluation will not be possible. So you have to check the fit, you have to evaluate the comfort. If the patient is judicious enough to explain to you what are the reasons for his uncomfortness on insertion, you can very well appreciate that and you can correct those areas. If the patient has got a vague kind of information which has been passed on to you regarding the comfort of the basal seat on insertion of the denture, then it is always preferably better to use the disclosing agent or disclosing paste to identify the area of discomfort and reduce that area from the tissue surface so that the patient is comfortable now on insertion of your complete denture. So that is how you check the comfort of your basal seat on insertion of your complete denture. And the next point which you are going to check after the assessing comfort of the basal seat on insertion of your complete denture, that is point number 9, is testing for the coincidence of centric occlusion and centric relation. That is testing for the coincidence of centric occlusion and centric relation. So you need to learn the definition of what is centric relation and what is centric occlusion. So in most of the cases in the natural teeth, there is a slight amount of disparity between centric occlusion and centric relation, but in your balanced denture or in your complete denture, you try to coincide both this centric occlusion and centric relation to one particular point. So it is very difficult to check in the mouth whether your centric occlusion and centric relation is coinciding unless you can detect a slight shift of the denture on its base when the patient closes. So to evaluate that in the oral cavity, you need to have a real good expertise, or you need to have a excellent you need to have excellent view of what is happening. So that is not possible during the initial time. So it is always better you do it in the articulator, because in most of the cases, this shift of the denture base during minor eccentric movement will go unnoticed in our oral, will not be noticed inside the oral cavity. So it is always better you remount your dentures using your new intraocclusal record as well as a new face bone transfer onto your articulator, and you check the coincidence of your centric relation and centric occlusion on the articulator, whether it is been coinciding. And once it is been found to be coinciding in the articulator, then it will be easy for you to say that it is been coinciding in the oral cavity. Because in oral cavity, there is always the presence of displaceable tissues, that is the periosteum as well as the mucosa, are displaceable in nature. So any any movement of the danger base on guiding of your complete danger into centric relation or centric occlusion will not be evident when you try to assess it inside the oral cavity. So it is always better that you try to do it in your articulator, and then you can follow up it inside the oral cavity. As the years passes on, you may acquire this clinical ability to identify this this variations inside the oral cavity itself, and for which you need to have a lot of practice, and you need to be really patient. You should be keen in observation. So for time being, the best and the good method of identifying the coincidence of centric relation and centric occlusion is to do a clinical remount using a new intraocular record and a face bore transfer. So moving on with the final point which you need to evaluate is the periphery of the dangers, that is the testing of the periphery of dangers for excessive thickness, height, and the snugness of your danger onto your mucosa. So as I told earlier, you should not have any excessive thickness or excessive height in your danger because of the sealing bags which you added on to your cast prior to your acrylization. You always try to mimic the exact thickness and height which you have created during your trying stage, and you need to just duplicate the thickness and height. Any sort of alternation which you have done to that can have a tremendous impact on the tonicity of the muscles around the mucosa, as well as there will be a change in the tautness of your mucosa because of the excessive amount of wax which has been added to the borders. So there is nothing much which I will be explaining on that. You have to only the point which I would like to stress again and again is you ask the technician, if the technician is doing the processing, that not to add excess amount of wax for sealing. If you yourself are doing, always try to eliminate the amount of wax, excessive wax which you utilize for sealing your complete danger. Use the required amount which has been required for sealing your complete danger for the master cast, and you do your acrylization based on the instructions of the material which has been provided by the manufacturer, and stick on to the proper curing cycles which you should be using when you do the acrylization. That is, either use the short curing cycle or long curing cycle as recommended, and follow the instructions properly, and do a gentle give sufficient amount of time for bench curing as well as bench cooling, and when you trim your danger also take necessary amount of precautions when you trim, so that there is no amount of stress which is being incorporated onto the danger, or there is no warpage onto the danger because of the excessive heat which you have created during your polishing of your dangers. These are the 10 points which you should remember, or these I would like to say these are the minimal points which I can say which you should look into when you insert a danger. You can, as I told earlier, you can add up more points from your side which you, which can improve the danger insertion, but from an academical point of view, these are the 10 points which you should remember when you insert your complete danger. So with this, I would like to conclude my session on danger insertion. If you have any doubt, you can post your doubt in the WhatsApp group, and we will clarify the doubts. I hope all of you will go through the lecture or interactive session and remember those 10 points, and I would like you all to implement these 10 points in your clinical practice when you do your insertion. Thank you all. This is the end of the session on train and danger insertion.